A very good morning to one and all. I, Dr. Rishikesh Singh Fauzdar, Assistant Professor, School of Law, Sharda University, would like to thank you for joining us. The Center Excellence in Environmental Law, School of Sharda University, is organizing a webinar on jurisprudence, environmental jurisprudence in India. As we know, the development of environment jurisprudence in India is from the right to environment is thus the enshrined in the basic framework of law of each and every country. The, like we have our country, India have amended our constitution in 1976. Various provisions are incorporated like Article 48A and 51AG as a fundamental duty. If you talk about the DPSP principle to protect, impose or improve the natural environment or a safeguard to forest and wildlife. And Article 51A as a fundamental duty, which imposes a duty upon the every citizen to protect and improve the natural environment, include the forest, lake, rivers, and have a compassion of living. In these words, for these things, for the contribution of these things, today we have our chief guest, Honorable Sri M.C. Mehta, sir. If you brief introduction about the sir, sir was born in October 1946 in belonging to the small village of district Rajouri in from the Jammu and Kashmir of state. Sir is a public interest attorney from India. He is a single-handedly won numerous landmark judgment from India Supreme Court in 1984, including the introduction, introducing a lead-free gas line to India, reducing the industrial pollution, appalling the Ganga, enduring the Taj Mahal. He was awarded various Goldman Environment Prizes in 1996 for his continuation fights in Indian courts against the pollution-causing industry. Apart from that, he also received the Raman Maksha Award for Asia for the public service in 1997. The Government of India awarded him the civilian honor of the Padma Shri in 2016. He is a trustee of the people for the and being a lawyer by profession and committed by environmentalist by choice. He has made the fight to protect India's environment his unending missions. He has a pioneer legal activism for the environmental protection. He's a proof that one man can make a different things. With these words about the brief introduction, now I would like to request Professor Pradeep sir, Dean of School of Sharda University, to welcome address to Sri M.C. Mehta, sir. Sir, please.
Thank you, Dr. Rishikesh. It is my proud privilege and an honor to welcome the chief guest, Padma Shri Raman Magsaysay and Goldman Environmental Prize awardee, Honorable Sri M.C. Mehta, a world-renowned environmentalist, in the webinar on environmental jurisprudence in India. As law faculty and residents, we know how important it is to read so many judgments of M.C. Mehta versus Union of India, M.C. Mehta versus State of Tamil Nadu. And as I was mentioning to Honorable Chief Guest that I have heard sir in various seminars and conferences, but first time we are face to face thanks to technology. And it is a privilege to students also to meet sir and learn from his untiring work, how much impact he has had made on environment of India. And he has set an example, as Dr. Rishikesh is saying, that how much an individual can change the scenario. And I would like to narrate that in early 1984, Honorable Sir, he visited Taj Mahal for the first time. And there he saw the famed monuments, marble, they were turning yellow. And he was feeling sad on this. And in Agra, if somebody belongs to that area, in early 80s, there were a lot of, you know, foundries, and they were spewing, you know, a lot of pollutants in the environment. And he came to Delhi and he filed the case to save this monument from pollution. And Supreme Court took this case and they ordered closure of all, you know, polluting small factories around close to 200. And they were asked to convert to clean fuel, CNG. And even up to Firozabad, because I belong to that area, it has improved the environment a lot, not only for Taj, even for, you know, people, those who are residing there. And then I'll tell you one more thing that in Delhi, you know, when we used to go in early 90s, if you wear a white shirt, it'll by the evening it will become, you know, grayish because of very heavy pollution of, you know, commercial vehicle they were plying on diesel. And it is a, you know, honorable sir's PIL which led to conversion of all commercial vehicle in Delhi to CNG. There were a lot of protests. Transport bodies were protesting. Even governments were scared. But sir was, you know, very clear in his thoughts that we have to protect our environment. So this two things I have seen which have changed lives of, you know, a lot of people, because clean air is required to survive. And in COVID we have seen how much we depend on, you know, on environment. And people understood that trees, how much they are important, because we were cutting trees and then we were running for oxygen. So these things I think sir could foresee in early 80s. That if we are not careful, we are going to head for disaster. And then we know in Tamil Nadu, children were working in, you know, cracker factories in Shivkasi district. And sir took their matter up, and it was a serious violation of the fundamental right of the children, right to, you know, Article 23 and 24. It was a violation. They were exploited. And in a very path-breaking judgment, you know, some funds were created for those poor kids. That just freeing them will not resolve the issue. We need to provide them some safety measures. And I'm sure all of us are keenly waiting to hear from sir. So with these words, I, on my own behalf, and on behalf of the management, faculty, non-teaching staff, students, and the participants, we are thankful to sir that he has taken out his precious time. And I want to tell one more thing that sir, one of our students, he wrote a letter to Allahabad High Court that a lot of medicines were seized by police in UP and they were getting destroyed. So Allahabad High Court treated that letter as PIL and issued directions to DM and SPs of the districts that these medicines should be distributed back to hospitals for you know, helping the poor patients. So I'm sure this law students will take a lesson from sir's actions and will help out the society at large. So thank you very much once again, sir. And I extend a very warm and cordial welcome to this webinar.
First of all, I would like to thank you for inviting me. I thought a number of times that I should speak with the faculty and students of the Sharda University, but unfortunately, so many programs and so many things were happening. So today, I'm again, you know, really happy to meet you in a virtual way, but we'll definitely meet, you know, again sometime.
Yes, sir. We'll call you on campus, sir.
Yes, I will definitely come.
Thank you very much.
And the question is that what I will just share some of my views and then about the environment, the jurisprudence, you know. Here in India, you know, you are all professors and you have done researches and everything, you know, on the environmental laws, and you are the best doctors for that. I, as a practitioner in environmental law, I learned that many things during the course of my going to the court and hearings and all that. So because you learn many things, you know, when you are there, and you learn so many things, you know, from the other side, you know, all the time, the hundreds of lawyers, you know, standing in the courtroom, and then facing all the wrath of the eminent lawyers and the other people, and you have to be, you know, but it's a learning. So now in India, you know, I don't want to repeat because you all know about the law. I will just share some of my views with that, how practical, in a practical way, we can really protect environment. And if we can protect, then there, then only we can really save this, we can serve to the nature. And I always say that now, this is a great lesson to all of us, that if one corona, which is an invisible thing, and it has shaken the whole world, we are all under arrest in houses, frankly. I am here in Dehradun right now. And for the last 1.5 years, we are just using this technical means of approaching each other. But physically, we are all afraid of going and even touching and even shaking hands or anything, you know. This is a fear. And this fear Who has done some invisible force? So whether it is this invisible force is again sending us a message that please behave properly, because we are, as a human species, we are the only species which destroys the nature more, puts harm in many ways, you know, because we have not learned the lesson of the need and greed, because these two things are very important. If we are living within our needs, then there is no problem. Yes, within the needs, we can protect the environment, we can protect the nature, we can protect rivers, lakes, and have compassion for animal life, and all these things we can do. But once we cross these limits, and then we enter into the zone of greed, then there is no end to that. There is no end. We will say that this world is even small for one individual, you know. And this is happening. You know that how many, you know, the thousands and thousands of acres of land are being forests and other lands are being taken by so many big companies now, and so they want to take over the whole world. So this is a greed, because they don't realize that they are not immortal. They are also mortal, and they don't have pain. Maybe that one of all of us, I wish that you cross even a century, but how long? The next, after a century, we can't. There is a law of nature, you know. We have to leave this mortal frame, and if we leave this mortal frame, then for what we are doing all these things? So this is this is the lesson which, you know, I learned in my own way from many, in many ways during the litigation and meeting with the wise people and all those. And I realize at that time, I said, no, this is not, you know, the development. The mantra of development itself is, very frankly, it is a lopsided total. Because development since you are all educationists and intellectuals sitting over here, and the students are there, you see that this development should be based on the happiness index. And the happiness index is, now can we have that happiness index? Can we achieve that? Because we have destroyed the rivers, the Ganga River, which is the most sacred river, and its water has been found. And even during the course of my litigation and all those fairings and everywhere, and it is a fact, you know, that the water is, many stretches of the river Ganga are unfit for drinking, washing, bathing, and irrigational purpose. I give you an example of Kanpur tanneries and all that, even despite the closure of those. And then now, even from the beginning, this is happening in the Himalayas are under serious threat. And that is the reason, you know, that from where the Ganga starts and the other Jamuna starts, and so many other rivers, the starts in from the mountains and these places, you see, in the south and in the north and the east and all that. So what is the state of affairs? So when we talk about the happiness, if we don't have water to drink, clean water to drink, because this is the first necessity. The first necessity is actually air we breathe. So the air we, by volume, you know, we breathe more air than water or the food. So we will not be living. No living thing. Everything breathes. So when we talk about the fresh air, where is fresh air? You see, Delhi has become one of the most polluted cities in the world. Every time it gets this distinction. So this is a great country, this great capital of a great country. Similarly, wherever I go, I traveled in many countries and all that. There too, the situations are there, but there the sensitivity is more. somewhere, you know, I took the cases in Nepal, you know, the first case I took about the there, and I went to the High Supreme Court. There, the people, their lawyers, they asked me to come. There, I sat with those lawyers, and I trained them in a hotel because the opposite, the mining lobby lawyers, they were going to object that I am a foreign national, I can't appear in the Supreme Court of Nepal. So fine. So when I came to know, so then at that time, similarly, they say, I sat with those young lawyers and I said, no, I will sit with you. In the courtroom, everybody is permitted to go. You take my pass, I will sit with you, but you prepare. And that happened. And then when this case started, it was huge the publicity given in the newspapers and all that this is happening and all that. But then when I went over there, they objected that, but they can't say that I was sitting quietly in the courtroom. And the matter came, and then when the matter came, the Chief Justice bench was there, and the lawyer, over a young lawyer, he started arguing the case. And then in the course of time, the judges said that they quoted all Indian Supreme Court judgments in the Supreme Court of Nepal. And then when they cited, and he was very clever, he said, one other lawyer, he said, luckily, Mr. Mehta, who has filed all these cases, he's sitting here. And all that strategy vanished, you know, in a few minutes. The Chief Justice said, where is he? So I was sitting there, and he said, no, we will take his assistance. Let him speak over here. At that time, the opposite lawyers, they could not say no. So this is why I'm saying that the environment has no boundaries. Whatever we breathe, the people they breathe over there in Nepal, or in Pakistan, or in neighboring countries, Bhutan, or anywhere. I have been to all these places, sat with the lawyers, prepared the cases with them, and then they filed in their own courts, whether it was Sri Lanka, it was Nepal, it was Bhutan, it was Bangladesh, or all other, in other, everywhere, you know, I try to see that, yes, we as a lawyer, if we know, and if we are sensitive, then we should all sit together, stand for a cause. And that is how it is. I think that some of the law students, they will become lawyers tomorrow, that they will become the distinguished professors and legal luminaries and all that. So everybody has to, or they will become the lawyers for the industry also. I don't mind, they should. But then as a lawyer, they have to give a right opinion, legal opinion to the client. That's very important. Why I'm saying that? Because if you say that only for making money, I say that no, fine. I don't worry, you are polluting, doesn't matter. I will take date for you. Are you are polluting? But visibly, if that happens, if the lawyer goes over there and sees the situation and brings a really story, and he can really tell his client that you are not going to win this case, because it is your duty. The laws are there. It is you have to do. You have to protect the environment. It is your fundamental duty. Whether it's a businessman or any person, we all, as the Indian Constitution has laid down the duties, Article 51AG, it shall be the duty of every citizen of India to protect environment, rivers, lakes, and have compassion for animal life. Now, where duties are, how many people are performing that duty? So, what my concern is that this is a very important aspect that if we have finished Gangaji, we have finished Yamunaji, all rivers, groundwater has gone, Professor Saab, about 700 feet, 1,000 feet down in the ground, underground water. I have been to in Rajasthan and other places, you see. And then, if you might have read that Indian Council for Environmental Action the case, you know, that in 1967, some of the cases were filed by Justice P.N. Bhagwati was the chairperson, president of this organization. He called me once after his retirement. He said, Mehta, you please go over there and you see what is happening. I have met people, and then they told me that you please, there is no water, and they showed me the bottles of water and all that, and please do something. Similarly, he called me once again. He said that you go to Tamil Nadu and see that what is going on over there, because the people are, they don't have drinking water, they don't have anything, and I am so sorry. That I said, sir, I will do, because he was a great judge, and then he was a great human being, and so I could not say no to him. But wherever I went in Tamil Nadu, in all the states, all in India, I saw only one thing which is common, that the misery, the frustration, the people, they can't have, if they don't have fresh water to drink, what will they do? If they don't have the air to breathe, what will they do? And then the food, that is most important, that they have to put inside. But if the child gets up in the morning and he takes milk, because in India, we all drink milk. And if that milk contains mercury contents, if it contains toxic contents, the animals, they, when they take this milk in the morning, even they contain all these things. With the sampling, you can see that what type of milk you are having, what type of water you are having. So this is why I'm saying that you, the Sharda University, but the professors and the students, they can really go deep into the expanding the jurisdictions. That will be a great thing for where, you know, really you can play a part. You can help, you know, the people, those who are practitioners, those who have the interest in doing such public litigation cases or something. But the court, you know that in 1986, the judgment, the court, the Supreme Court said that there should be environment courts in the country. And in one of the cases which I did that. And then that's the court, if this sensitivity of the government would have been there, that the state should have been there, then they should have set up courts in 1986 itself. Or even they were sleeping for 5 years, fine, in 90s, in 200, in 2000. Now imagine, you know, that now the situation is out of control. Because they talk about GDP, now where is the GDP of this country? You can see minus 23 or minus 24. When we talk about 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, this is what happened. And then it has come. And now, how it has happened? Because over this policies were good. Policies, if you read the Indian, all these policies, you know, the planning and the all those things, whatever it comes to the table and you read, you say that's perfect. It should be like that. But where is the perfection? The perfection is in action. If the directive principles are there, the fundamental rights are there, if the state policy is there to do all those things, you know, which are enshrined are in the enactments and everything, you know, then there's no need for why should I spend my whole life in the Supreme Court of India for these things? Or why you or any other citizen, how much time, you know, that it is an unequal battle, sir. It is unequal battle. On the one hand, when they battery of 500 and 410 1,000 people, they come. In some of the cases, they don't have, they can't even enter inside. But they their meter is on as far as this, because once they accept the brief, it is on. You know that, all those things. But the suffering of the person who is doing this case, the intimidation, the pressure that they generally, you know, they start saying many, oh, they're wasting the court's time, So this is, if this is the attitude, you're wasting the course time, what will you do? And what we are asking, what anybody in the public interest litigation, it is a very sacred weapon, you know. It is a very sacred thing. And this, if it is utilized properly, it can relieve the people from the misery. It can really help the innocent people. Whether you might have read this, you're saying that the child labor case. And the child labor case, I was in Bhagwati said that please go and see that there in the slate industries and other than the match factories and all that. When a child is huddled at 2 in the morning in the buses, like vegetables are put in one truck, you know, and they are sold to the they are going to the market, you know, for sale. Similarly, this human, the child labor is being used in Sivakasi and so many other places in the country. You know, I can give you name, you know, and then these people, the children are huddled, their parents, they all that, and then they go, and then what they were getting? 2 rupees a day, or 3 rupees a day. The firecrackers, firecracking industry, all these things. So you can imagine that if such things happen, what there is, the children, you know, aquaculture case which I did, and that shaped the whole world, you know, and it gave a different view to the world. And then the judges from different countries, they started looking into this, that okay, this case is there, and then the lawyers in those countries, they used that, and then those judgments of the, that is S. Jagannathan versus Union of India and others. That I that case, which was a, it became a landmark case where, you know, whole world, the shrimp farming case, and that shrimp farming, even the chief minister and the politicians, big politicians, they were having their own shrimp farms. So when I went over there, a person who was a half blind, this. But he was a great Gandhian, you know, the freedom movement person. So he was about 78 or so something, and just Bhagwati called me. He said, "Mr. Mehta, he's there. You please go." I said, "Sir, how many times I have to go to do these things? It is very difficult for me." He said, No. It is, you please go." And then I went over there, and how the children, how the people, and how this whole the prawn culture, the big industrialists, they were involved in this whole game plan. They, when you call this shrimp farming, and then shrimp, you know, that even the eggs of that the fish, they are collected on the tip of the tongue, and then they are being put in the water, and then that egg that is being, you know, for trading purposes and for other growing purposes, shrimp farming and all that, they were being used. And then I was attacked there, on the sea itself, you know, on the side where, you know, the meeting was being held, you know, and then it was very difficult. They saved me. Because there was about, the people were about 10,000-15,000 people over there, and then all of the, some of these people they put inside all the type of gundas and all that, and they would try to disturb and all that. But why I'm saying this? Because I'm saying this, that young, the people, those who are going to be young lawyers tomorrow,
Prakriti, please check.
Sir's connection has been lost. I'm trying to.
Please restore.
Yes.
Let us wait, because it can happen in this connectivity issues come. And I think because of hot weather, these are more frequent. By the time sir is joining, we can have some, you know, as sir was suggesting, that we can have some, you know, some causes we can take up.
Sure, sir. Especially the way he talked about water issues.
Yeah. And he also was saying that, you know, expanding jurisdiction, that it is not only India specific, even our neighboring countries are also facing same issues.
Yeah.
So we can take up some cause. Now rainy season is coming, so we can take up even water harvesting, because we have water harvesting system in our buildings or university, but they may be not in proper shape. So we can take some time and ensure that they are in good shape, so that water is harvested back to earth.
Yeah. We can help restore rain harvesting system in our universities.
Yeah, university has, but we can see whether it is working or not.
Yes, sir.
So we can go there. So I'll go there and I'll see whether it is working, or we can have more such water harvesting places. Or in our society also we have, so we can see whether they are working or not, or they are covered, they may not be, you know, they may be in disuse. So we all can make our, you know, efforts, so that in whatever way we contribute to the environmental welfare. Basically, on 5th June, we were having this World Environment Day, and because of that, you know, World Environment Day, we are having this series of guest lectures. So we had Dr. Rajendra Singh, Waterman of India, in previous guest lecture, and today we have Honorable M.C. Mehta, sir. And we all know M.C. Mehta versus Union of India, so many cases, more than I think 250 cases, where he has single-handedly fought, you know, big industries.
Sir, in India, we can't teach environment law at school or university level without talking about M.C. Mehta ji.
Even Article 21, without his cases, is incomplete.
Absolutely.
Because right to clean water, right to clean air is a part of Article 21, right to life and personal liberty. So they have given their life, and in a very, you know, Gandhian way. So now we can take inspiration and we can take it forward. We have, you know, lot of young mind, lot of well-meaning students and faculty. So we all can join hands and make good impact. One person could make such a large impact. So we'll call sir whenever university reopens. We'll call sir to campus. Because nothing can replace one-to-one hearing in auditorium.
Absolutely,
sir. That gives a different, feeling. Like in technology, now we are facing this glitch.
Yes, sir.
So it is having its own shortcomings.
Sir, let me check with the office if they are able to get through, sir.
Prigati is on work. He's trying.
I'll request all the participants to please hang on. We are getting in touch with sir, and maybe in 2-3 minutes he'll join back. Thanks for your patience, everyone.
Sir, Dean sir. Sir is here, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank
Welcome
you, sir.
Back, sir.
Yes, okay. Yes. So, which we want?
Sir, you may continue, sir.
Yes, okay. So, can you hear me now?
Yes, sir, clearly.
Yes. Yes. So, in any case, I was talking about the shrimp farming and all, because I don't know that the students, they are studying such cases or not, you know, in their course. But such cases, you know, should be really, they will help in building their career, you know, in a better way, you know, in learning many things and all that. The other thing which I'm going to say is that the like in 1991, the Supreme Court, you know, in one of my cases, you said that environment will be a compulsory subject throughout India, in schools, in colleges, and at a degree at other levels. This is not being enforced properly. When I filed three times, I went again to the court because I received so many complaints from all over the country, from so many universities and schools and all, that sir, nothing is happening. They are not implementing, and they say that the teaching of environment will waste time of the students. So if this is the thinking of the authorities, you know, that this will waste the time, that if they don't know that they breathe air, they drink water, they need uncontaminated food to eat, and still they are so ignorant that they don't know that why it should have been given the priority number one, you know. But at least the Supreme Court of India has shown them the path that you do this, because this is a fundamental duty and Article 51 AG, and under that duty now you have to do that. So in many universities, they have those who are really serious and sensitive, they introduced this subject, and many still they are lacking just to for the marks sake, you know, that fine, you know, and they have not given positions to the many of those people, those who did even PID environmental laws and so many other subjects, you know, which could have helped, you know. So what I'm trying to say that here, it is the court's role is not there to implement the, it is the role of the people, the concerned citizens of this country. And concerned citizens, the most concerned citizens are the institutions, educational institutions, because they have to be put pressure that why can't we introduce this subject, and why we should be waiting if half an hour or 1 hour, they should be given the training in different ways. I in my eco ashram, sometimes sir, I will request you to come, and there the hundreds of the students, those who come came from different countries, and in that eco ashram we don't have that big buildings or anything. We just, you know, in a simple way we spend time together. They go and then they go and see the industries in incognito. They go there and then they come, and each one on each subject, you know, they say, oh, this is what, you know, we never knew and how. And then the people, they were helping them that, okay, this is, because if you can't get in your village a drinking water, what will you do, you know? From where they will go? They are not rich people that they need, they will call the Bisleri water, and then they will be, because they are so poor, or even middle class people. But once, this is the first right. That clean air to breathe and fresh water to drink, uncontaminated water to drink. So if this is a cocktail of so many things, you know, even in the milk, as I was saying, that if there's a mercury and there are other heavy metals are all those in that milk. So we proudly give that milk, you know, to our children, you know, every day. And you don't know that what type of pollutants are there in that milk, or in the water, in other sources, in the food chain itself, you know. So that is the reason that we I say it should not be taken otherwise. I say that if that goes on, then India will become a huge cancer hospital itself. Is this the way? And this cancer, how do you please just, you know, put your some of the students that will, I will be very grateful. And that, what was the rate of cancer in 1947 when we got the independence? And after that, how much people, how many people, how many cancer? I only know that there was only one hospital, a cancer hospital in Bombay at that time. Just Tata Cancer Institute or something. Hardly, there were no occupancy. There was no patients for very less. Now, this is like a household, the other diseases, waterborne diseases, how much, you know? So some of the students of yours, sir, you can ask them, there's some air, some water, some other, and they can do PhD, they can do the dissertation, the small, you know, the interest they can take, and then they can really change. And that will be a great contribution. Because wherever I have gone, I was in Bangladesh, I sat there in the Supreme Court of Bangladesh, and I trained lawyers there. And they filed the first case in Bangladesh. Similarly, in other, though we say that Pakistan is the enemy country, that's a different thing. But environment, I always tell them that the Pakistanis, they don't breathe air, or they don't drink water. Are India, Indians, that we don't do. They hear, you know, that the lawyers, when they came here, and the lawyer, one of the lawyer, he was later, you know, he was promoted to judge of the Lahore High Court. And then now he is the Supreme Court judge. And they were here for 6 weeks at the Eco Ashram. And they said we changed. They are changed people. So I don't say that 100% we will get the results. But even I say that 25% to 50%, even if we achieve, that is a great achievement, because environment through and law, you can see the Pakistan jurisprudence also. They have quoted, though we are saying that we are enemy countries and this and that. I said, where is the question? When the judges from there, they came from the Supreme Court, and they were here, and they were similar. They took the Ganga water from Rishikesh. They said, we want to give that Ganga water to our Hindu friends in Pakistan. So you can see that how this environment, it is not an enemy. It is a bridge for creating more relations, good relations, and it can really change. And then, especially SAR countries, you know, I was the, in 1998-99, I was invited to frame the laws of the Bhutan. Bhutan is the only country where they respect the nature, you know, more than any country in the world, you know, others. And they are doing no, but then Bhutan. But 4 or 5 days we all sat together in and huddled there, because I did not have the time, and the laws were framed. And if you see that index, the happiness index of Bhutan is more in the world than any other country, because they are so careful. Even going there for a tourist, you know, from we in the SAR countries, we can go there, but if somebody has to, my friends, they wanted to go to US, from US to some lawyers, they wanted to go to Bhutan, and they applied and they got visa after about five years, because they have a set norm, and they nobody can just go and be pollute there or do anything wrong. So my only, why I am saying this, because I am very happy to be here with you and sharing my views, and then you can really do Sharda University can really do take a lead in this as far as environmental protection is concerned. As far as this, so you are there, and you have a huge manpower, the sources are there. The young people you have with you. So this is my. So I don't want to. If anybody has a question, I will be happy to give a reply. But I physically, when the Corona is over or some situation arises, I will come and visit your university also. I will be very happy, and we should be meeting and we should be talking. And your students, we can. We are going to have more programs in future also here at the Eco Ashram. There we have planted trees and all that, but nothing, you know, they have to do everything on their own. And they go into the factories, they go into so many other places, and then they realize that, oh yes, here internship, this is the internship, you know. From foreign countries, when some of my friends, they tell me that you please accept one. From France, the students, they came. From other countries, when they come, they are put, they work more for me and then anybody else. They go, I send them, you do this, and they come and then they write like a thesis, you see, and give it to me. And then they present in the department in the France or in the USA, in other countries, in the university from where they have come, you know. So that will be a wonderful thing, that we can have some exchanges, something, you know, we can exchange our views. And this is not the first day. I'm very happy. This is the means, and we can talk with each other through virtual meeting. And in future, we should continue. And I will be there whenever you call me. We will be trying to see that adjust timing and do something together. Thank you so much.
That shall be great mentoring, sir, of our future generation of advocates.
Thank you so much, sir, for sharing your personal experience with regard to various aspects of environment, sir. I was, when you went off air, so I was discussing with Dean, sir, generally we can't study in schools or colleges environment without talking about you, sir. I too teach environment, so first lecture I always introduce you. How, because of you, we have environmental jurisprudence, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for taking out time and being here, sir. I have one question from one of our students who's a second year student. The way you started with COVID issue, his question is related to COVID issue. His name is Anirudh, sir. He wants to ask, sir, as we all have witnessed the sense of purity in the air and environment during lockdown, but as we headed towards unlock, we started to revert back to pre-lockdown situation of environment. Kindly suggest how can both environment and economy be balanced to maintain the essence of purity in environment.
The first thing is that he did a very good question, you know, which he has raised. And the first thing is that first we have to become more aware. First, you know, that if as a citizen we become aware, then whether the second thing is that if the political leadership, you know, when I talk to some of the people, you know, because I don't belong to any party. So I tell them, I frankly tell them, for what, you know, you are running these governments, you know. I'm very frank in telling some of the people, and they say, why? I said that you can visit there in your constituency. One of the MPs, I told him, I said, have you visited your constituency fully? He said, no. It is a long, big constituency. I can't travel everywhere. I said that, but when you became this MP, at that time you said that, yes, I'm going to nurse my this constituency. Are you doing that? He said, why you are talking to me this way? I said, he was feeling that offended, you know, that okay. I said, no, I have been to these places. These are, you are member of parliament from that constituency. You please go and visit, and then we will talk. And then I told those people, I said that I will send you some people also. And I said, you take all those bottles of water, you know, contaminated water, and tell them ki aap sir is pani ko to aap ghar mein yahi istemal kariye aainda se aap dekhiye. He called me back after a week. He said, you were right, because I did not know, and I'm trying to do so. It is not that sometimes the people are not aware of on these issues, whether they are in power or without power, you know. But we have to try as a citizen of this country to make aware everybody, whether it's a child or anything, a big businessman, you know, he came one day, Because I don't meet businessmen, because the reason is that maybe that their industry or some reason they might. After a friend of mine, he suggested that, no, please, he's a good man, you just talk to him. And he talked to me on phone. I said, you please tell me. He said, sir, I don't have anything to say other than this, that my son, who is in a school and he is in 10th class, he wants to come and work in your office for some time. I said, why? He said, no, one thing is that he got a breathing problem. And he is very, insecure. He feels insecure. And he said that, approach, Mr. Mehta's office, and, if I can come over there. The boy came and he sat with me. And then I said, why are you here? You are not going to learn too much. You can't be a lawyer immediately, You have to do law, you have to do this. I said, if you want to be a lawyer, then you start doing these things. And then, now he's a lawyer. But then at that time, he was a student. After this schooling, he joined the college, then after that. But that person, became a real gem, Because he started going into the green marches with us. He started going there, here, there, everywhere. And he was holding meetings. And he, a passionate person, he became passionate in the mission, of protecting the environment. And then the same industrialist, he said, you have changed his whole attitude. And thank you very much. I was also a polluter. He admitted, I was also a polluter. But my son, he stopped everything. He said, no, otherwise you close down this industry. That is a wonderful spirit, that if a family member comes out and he starts saying that, no, for whom you are running this industry? For the family interest, for making money? We don't want this. So he said, no, sorry, I was wrong. So sometimes, by experience, you learn many things. Rather, discussing and debates and all that. We don't need debate in these issues at all. We only say that, yes, three things are important, and these three things, the air, water, and the food, healthy food. All, if they are there, then our environment can be protected, and this all gives the nature. And then we have to respect nature. We have to pray nature that give us the strength to do wonderful things in life and for the country and for the whole universe. Thank you so much.
Thanks for such an elaborate response on this question, sir. One more question, sir. What is your take on the question that are we in Indian jurisdiction able to do justice to tribal rights to nature? Because that is the only community which is in total, living in total sync with nature.
Yes, yes. You see that we have to, I have been to those tribal areas also, in Madhya Pradesh, in some parts in south, and in other areas in east and all that, where the tribal peoples are there. And they are not destroying the nature. Actually, they are the friends of nature. The only thing is that when the coal mines, I give you an example, coal mines. And the coal mines, those who are digging the coal, they are the polluters actually. And then, because the reason is that all the loading and unloading and all so many things, the projects are coming in all those areas, tribal, and then it is creating a disharmony between them and the industry which is being run over there. Because if you read that one case, Udaipur case, that is, I will give you the name, I don't remember. I took that case, and where the 100 crore of rupees fine has been put by the Supreme Court of India in that case, they were small scale industries and they were making HSF. And that case, again, I was referred by some of the judges and some of the other people, they said that you please do that. And then I filed that case, and then ultimately the things happened that they were provided with the drinking water. And so that was the first thing. And then, when I went over there, their animals were drinking the same acidic water. a small scale industry. It was not a big scale industry. Small scale industry started edge asset making, and that edge asset, you know, and then they hired people. The eminent lawyers were engaged and all that. I told those eminent lawyers, I said, please, you know, just see. Then ultimately one day I took the bottle in my hand because they were not having a drinking water. And in the court room, they were all the people, they were fighting, you know, that no, it is wrong, it is wrong. I just took the bottle, put on my desk, you know, and one of the honorable judges, presiding judge, he said, what is this? I said, my lord, this is the drinking water. If my friend in the other side can drink that water, I will withdraw this case right now. And that friend, you know, he said, no. The first reaction, you know, no, I can't drink this water. So the court at that time, you know, said that is what, you know, whatever I said, the court provided the first the drinking water, then medical facilities, then the further the reports, and the needy and other scientists, they went over there to further, you know, investigate the things. So these are practical things, you know, which we do. We don't want to obstruct the course of the judicial course are in any way. We only want that what the people, everybody has the right to drink clean water or air, breathe air, and then have a good food. But if they are taking that Coca-Cola color water inside and that acidic water, you know, which the animals were the same they were drinking, and then we say that cow is our mother. But you know, the cow that I can't tell you this scene, you know, that it is unforgettable. The cows and the other animals, they were putting their this tongue in the water, and because that was so acidic that they were immediately, you know, because it was like the shock to them. Then again, but they were, it was this, I think about temperature was 50, 49, 50. This is the Udaipur case. So HS factories, small scale industries. It is not that they were huge, but it was a wrong action. So they took the licenses in the name of the small secretary. And so my concern is that please, you know, that you can give this education through your guidance and leadership to the students that, yes, they should first the visit also. Not only read whatever, you know, or whatever I'm saying, they should feel that, and then once they feel, they will be championing the cause of the environment for the protection of human beings and all living beings on earth. That is what my response is. Thank you.
Thank you for your guidance, sir. I think Dr. Rishikesh, my colleague, also have few questions for you, sir. Rishikesh.
Thank you, sir. Yes, ma'am. I have one question, sir.
Yes.
Rishikesh, please unmute yourself.
Yes, sir. One question from the Pranjal Tiwari, Pranjal Chaturvedi from fourth year. The every government is well aware about the mechanism of environment protection, but where does actually problem lies that government is not able to execute its idea of protection of environment?
So you are right that actually, as I told you, that this judgment, you know, even if this judgment, frankly, if this would have been enforced in the shortest period, you know, if you read that judgment, in the shortest possible time, the Supreme Court delivered that judgment. They said this is the way, you know, it has to be. But in again, that judgment, you know, and following that judgment, the directions which have been given, because environment has become a compulsory subject throughout India in that. And so many other, that every day the programs on TV, air networks and all that should be given. So for as a cosmetic approach, you know, some of the channels, you know, they give, because again, three times I filed the contempt petitions in the same matter. And then the judges, they called all the chief secretaries of the country, you know, they were there in the courtroom. And then they said, and they put in affidavits and all that we are going to do, sir. And just, you know, because they were under contempt and all that. But I because India is a big country, I don't know how many places, you know, that it is being implemented. And where that is, what is the role, sir, of you can really, you know, put some of your students, you know, that okay, see that okay, which place is it is missing, where is it is not being implemented, and what is the reason for that, then it will be really help to me also and to the cause, not to me but to the cause, you know. So, and then those students can really, you know, file in their names, in whatever they want to do, they can do.
Sir, in all leading institutions, EBS is compulsory subject. Environmental studies is a compulsory subject in all leading universities, including ours.
Yes.
But we can do a project that if anybody is not taking it serious, we can certainly, because the student will be benefited if EBS is brought to
them. Even, sir, UGC, they, and then the technical universities and all that, they gave, they have given affidavits in the court. But then the, because the people, they change, the UGC chairman will change, the vice chairman will go, and then again the things will again do the same way, you know, there are many things. So, yes.
Sir, with your kind permission, can I take up one more question from one of our PhD scholars?
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Please. Shahid Parvez wants to know, sir, please enlighten us on the issue of independent environment regulator. Will it be beneficial or harmful?
No, it is a good question. The independent regulator, you know, of course, independent regulator, if it is under the direct under the government, you know, then it is not going to help, frankly. Or like the pollution control boards, where, frankly, you know, the polluter, they are regulators, actually. The central pollution control board, the state pollution control boards, but then they have to be, their administrative system, you know, that should be, that has to be looked into properly, because they come there for 3 years, 2 years, and if it is a cadre long, then they have to be made accountable personally. Then, you know, then it will make difference. But otherwise, if I give a license today to a polluting industry, as I mentioned to you, that the small scale industry, you know, which destroy the whole of 7 or 10 kilometers of distance, that is Indian Council for Enviro Legal Action versus Union of India and others. That is what the case I was referring to about Udaipur case. And there, Justice Dalveer Bhandari, he was later on became the justice in the International Court of Justice. So he was the presiding judge. He heard that case, and you can read the judgment that 100 crores of rupees, you know, that fine has been imposed on that. That person has disappeared now. So now he is underground, but he is running the things, you know. So that is the job of the government or the authorities to catch hold of that man, put into the jail or whatever, you know, take his properties, because that will be a deterrent for others also. It will teach a lesson to others. No, we can't, you know. That 100 crores, if it has not been deposited so far. I don't have the latest information, but it has not been. That was the compensation to be paid to the people, affected people, the loss of the environment over there, then the people's life and health, and although their lands have totally been polluted. And the groundwater is polluted. And you know that Rajasthan is very scarce, water scarce area. So this is what we have, we can do that way. That such teams are made, if Sharda University can take a lead, I will be more than happy. That, you know, that okay, make a 4 or 5 people and said they can do as a project. You do, and it will be a great help. Yes, because name is so sacred, you know, so it should be, you know, it will be really good. The university's name, Sharda, you know. Mashada, you know. So, any other thing, sir? Anything? We will be ready.
Thank you, sir, for enlightening us on this. Dean, sir, do you have anything to add, or I can propose a formal vote of thanks?
Now, sir is our mentor for life, so we will keep bothering sir for his mentoring.
Yes, sir. Thank you. I have to learn many things from you, sir.
That is your humility, sir. We are so it's a privilege to be in your audience.
Thank you. I'm so happy to meet you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, can I propose a formal vote of thanks? Or?
Yes.
Thank you so much, sir. Thanks for granting the permission.
Thank you.
A graceful and warm afternoon to our most valued, respected guest, M.T. Mehta, sir, dear faculties and beloved students. It's my proud privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on the occasion of webinar on environmental jurisprudence in India. I, Dr. Lipika Sharma, Associate Professor, School of Law, Sharda University, on behalf of entire fraternity and management here, extend a very hearty gratitude to our resource person, Mr. M.C. Mehta, for gracing the occasion and sharing with us his esteemed views and enlightening the gathering with his opinion on protection of environment. And sir, thanks for sharing your personal experiences, which has elaborated or added on to already existing knowledge base with regard to environment, sir. Environment law, as I told you, can't be taught without talking about you in any school or educational institution at all, sir. Thanks a lot, sir, for sparing a time for us. It is indeed a privilege to have you with us, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, we are blessed to have you indeed, all of us. And there is a huge number of participants. Participants joined this webinar is more than 200, sir.
Thank you. We'll meet again. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
I would like to lastly thank our respected Dean, sir, for encouraging us and Center for Excellence in Environment Law to conduct this kind of webinars for fruitful deliberations in the area of environment. Thanks a lot, sir. And lastly, I would like to thank all the participants to joining in such a big number and participating in this deliberation. And thanks a lot to Pragati, Rishu and Sudesh ji for their continuous support.
And the power of idea is in execution. Let us execute the idea of Honorable Sir.
Absolutely, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Lipika, for wonderful webinar. And I am sure we will carry this environmental protection in our lateral institutes.
Sure, sir. And as guided by sir also, we'll get in touch with sir and we'll take it forward.
Of course. Thank you. Thank you.
Sir,
thank
you. I have got some message for internship with in your ashram and within your office. So,
sir, we will invite you as a resource person. It will be really wonderful, you know. We all different people, but we sit down and under the grass and learn from each other and whatever. Yes,
sir. I shall make a dream come true, sir.
Thank
good day, sir.
Thank you.
Good day, sir.
Thank you,
everyone. Have a wonderful